BoxtoBox overlap and the Springboks have just lost 13-8 to Ireland in their Group B clash at the Rugby World Cup. This felt like a final, but it wasn't a final. It's so much to talk about. I don't even know if we have enough time to do this. So we're just going to get straight into it. The Box went 29 minutes without scoring a single point. The game ended 13-8. The last score was in the 51st minute when Colby got scored a try on the wing off some great work in the scrum from the bomb squad, which we're just going to get into right now. So our first thing to talk about in this game was the set pieces. Set pieces really, they set the tone for this game. Whether it was the Irish line-out failing the first four times, whether it was the scrums, winning scrums at crucial times to get you into, to give you territory or to give you a proper exit, yeah, when you're in your own 22. I think for the Irish, they did well to sort their line-out in, to get their line-out in order. So the first four line-outs were just, went haywire, including one in the 22, in South Africa's 22. And after that, they got their set piece right. They got their lineouts right. And the first one they got right was the one that led to Hugo Keenan getting a chance, getting so close to the line, and then they ended up dropping the ball just in front of the line. But it was a lineout. They did their typical lineout moves, like around the 50-meter, the halfway line, and they gained all that, all those meters and just knocked it on in the South African 22. So when the lineout is working 100% from the get-go, like they would have scored, you know, crazily. But again, this was world number one versus world number two. They were good. These teams are so good. They're going to take away something that each other does. So for example, the Springboks just took out, like the Irish were not comfortable on the ball. They were not doing those multi-phase moves that they normally do. Getting over the advantage line easily to set up that wraparound move for Sexton or Bandieki. South Africa took that away, especially in the first 29 minutes of the game, up until Bandieki had that line break, which, by the way, was actually off another scrum down, off an Irish scrum down that led to Bandieki breaking through. And subsequent to that is when Ireland got their first try. So Ireland, they some aspects of the game were taken away, and they also took away some aspects of South Africa's game. And that's expected from a world number one versus number two. It's how you deal with that pressure and how much pressure you can offset such that you're not under the cosh the entire game. So I feel like in the set pieces, South Africa tried to impose themselves. Franco Mostert reminded me of like Victor Matfield of like 2009. This guy was just, he was causing pain for the Irish lineout. They managed to sort it out. And other times they switched to like a five-man lineout, you know, trying to have some movement before the, some motion before the lineout actually takes place to take a say off their guard. And yeah, finally the lineout was working for the Irish. For South Africa, one of their strongest points of their games is their lineout. So for them not to have a lineout in the Irish 22 up until the 70th minute was actually quite surprising to me. That's something that the Irish took away from South Africa. South Africa are so good at building pressure, right? They're so good at putting you under the cosh. They're so good at like dominating you through set pieces, through lineouts, through contact, like making you uncomfortable. And they just couldn't make the Irish uncomfortable. I feel like South Africa had a chance here of just going after Ireland, especially in their own 22. And this leads me to the kicking. There were times when they build up pressure, they let Faf de Klerk kick. The first one that came off the post, I think that was still a good time. It was still like 30-something, 20-something minutes left in the game. It's only a one-score game. A kick takes you to 11-10, right? So it was not a bad time to do that. But there were times when they'd win a scrum, or they'd win a penalty rather, and instead of going for touch and building up that pressure, because if there's anything we learn from even the game that they beat the All Blacks in the warm-up, if you put, there is no team in the world. These teams are good. The All Blacks are good. The Irish are good. But if you put these teams under enough pressure, something will crack. Something has to give, right? South Africa are so good at building pressure, be it scoreboard pressure through their kicking, be it the line moving up quick, like putting you out of your comfort zone, right? Their high line pressure, be it scrum pressure, line out, like that's what they live off of. And then once they get that penalty advantage, then they can play freely after that. South Africa don't play freely without that penalty advantage. So they have forwards that play towards that, like towards just pressure. And the backs, like if you could show it even in Jesse Creel. Jesse Creel, they got a scrum down and in the 22, in the Irish 22. And when he went into contact, he's trying to offload the ball where Siya Kolisi is coming in to clear the ruck so that they can go for phases. And it's that lack of decisiveness, right? Where the backs are trying to play like from the back, like to play with hands, and the forwards are trying to play like typical South African rugby. Them not being on the same page. These combinations is what makes Ireland, especially with Leinster, like Leinster players, there's so many Leinster players in this squad. Those combinations are the ones that make them so dangerous because they're on the same page at any given moment. At times, an Irish player has the ball and he just does this, right? Knowing very well someone is coming for a short ball. And they're not confused, you know? And it's those combinations that you have to break. You have to test those combinations via South Africa. You test them through hard contact, dominating collisions like they did in the first 29 minutes. Like, those are some of the things that you do. Manny Lebok. Manny Lebok did some things well. I feel like Manny Lebok, with ball in hand, is an amazing player. Some of the kicks he does off hand are really, like, spot on. But the pressure of him being put in a South African side, which is very dependent on dominating the opposition through physicality. And then once they dominate you and win the penalties, they want to kick for goal and get points. If you're not an 80% kicker, that you are going to look bad regardless. Manny Lebok is an amazing player, but because of how his team plays, he looks bad. His first good kick of the game, actually there's one grabber that he did, but his proper first kick of the game that was impressive was in the 78th minute when he kicked for corner, right? He kicked for the corner when they won a penalty, and off that line out, the ref deemed it an unplayable ball, and that's how the game was iced for Ireland, right? So those aspects of that he did well, but then obviously when you miss 11 points, missed a conversion that wasn't too far away, missed a conversion, he then missed a penalty. Faf de Klerk missed two penalties. Like, they are... I mean, they had to call up Pollard. Like, now I see it, right? But the problem is, now you've weakened your hooker position, your hooking spot. It's messed up with your rotations because now Mbonambi has to play just a bit longer and Dion Fury only gets, like, that 20 minutes or 15 minutes. Whereas earlier, when Marco Max was in, you'd do, like, a 50-30 minute split between your starting hooker and your sub hooker, right? And yeah, now you're putting pressure on the hooking department. Like, it's unnecessary pressure, because had you selected Pollard from the get-go, everything was telling us you have to select Pollard, even if he wasn't fit. We have seen you guys play rugby. We have seen Manny Lebok kick for goal in the warm-up games, in the rugby championship. This was something that everyone knew. But the team insisted on picking him up. And if you insist on picking him up, then you have to use your forwards more. If he's not good at kicking at goal, once you get penalties, you have to go for touch every other time, you know, at least create pressure. You have chances of scoring five. You have the best line-out in the world. Best rolling mole in the world. The first rolling mole in this game came in the 77th or 7-something minute, right? That's not going to cut it for the South African team. If they're going to stick with Lebok and Faf de Klerk as your halfback combination, you have to put your pack in positions to actually roll over and dominate the opponent. The spine of the team, the hooker, the locks, your number 8 scrum half, fly half, fullback, those are people you just don't mess around with, right? You don't shift and change the spine of the team. For Ireland, impressive win. I was quite impressed with their defense. Actually, both teams had impressive goal line defense. Collisions were massive. Like, South Africa dominated the first 29 minutes of the game, but it's not like Ireland let up, right? South Africa dominated through defending. Their contact, I said dominated in the sense of they did not let the Irish get over the advantage line, because that's what Ireland want to do. And it's not that Ireland were being pushed back that much. They just were not doing what they normally do, right? So they were dominated in that sense. They couldn't play their brand of rugby for the first 29 minutes. When Bandy Aki made that break, then all hell broke loose. You know, all hell broke loose. The both teams forced knock-ons in the 22, like in their own 22 for the opposing team. I feel like the defenses were really good. The collisions were amazing. Like when Dialinde hit Sexton, that is how Sexton gets injured. Those off the ball, like once he releases the ball and he gets hit, that is how he gets injured. I've seen him get injured like that so many times. And for him to have played 70 minutes unscathed was really good, positive for Ireland. He probably has like 4 more games in his rugby career, so he knows he can give his all, but he cannot get injured. He can't get injured. And they had to bring on, not Ross Byrne. Jack Crowley had to come on and ice the game, 73 minutes. I need to mention the bomb squad. Like, these guys, they came on and caused immense pain for, like, 48 minutes, Kitschoff went off, Eben Etzebeth and Franco Mostard all went off for Oxenche, Jean Klein, and Arge Snyman, who also had an amazing break. So South Africa had chances. He had a really good break, but it led to nothing. And I think that bomb squad is like when Ox and Trevor came on, those boys are on something, bro. Like I love the bomb squad. I wasn't a fan of it. This 7-1 split, I wasn't a fan of it, but now like yeah, you can't fault it. Like I know they're trying something new, but you can't fault it. The guys are actually they're putting in work, right? Whereas Ireland's bench came on and they tried to keep up with the physicality, and I think they did a good job. I don't think there's nothing. Ireland's game plan worked. I feel like it worked, not to perfection, because there are things that they would have liked to have done which they didn't do. Being like, for example, be more clinical in their 22, but South Africa took that away. But for our number one playing number two in a Rugby World Cup game, this should have been the final. This game was so intense. Like there is so much that I'm even still yet to like touch on, and I things like Manny Libok, like when, for example, I don't want to sound rough on Manny, but there was one brain fart that he had when Jack Crowley went for the drop goal, and then I think it was Damien Dialinde who charged it down. It's common sense that if the ball is charged down, if it goes into touch, it's going to be taken back, right? Like, well, I think it's common sense. So for us, a flyer for a team that's number two in the world, that's something you should know. And it was off that scrum down that led to the penalty that iced the game. Because after that, Crowley kicked the conversion, or rather the penalty that made it 10-13-8. So, yeah, it's those moments of... At the end of the day, I know it's a small thing, but in the context of this game, it's a big thing. Because these are the two top teams in the world. They will be scrutinized like to the T, because that's who they are. They've proven they're the best, so you have to treat them like the best. It's these 1%ers that make the difference. So if you can't be switched on during these moments of the game, then you just have to be called out. But I really feel bad for Manny Libok, because he's such a good player. It's just that his kicking will always be highly scrutinized. It's like Boden Barrett at the All Blacks. Boden Barrett is not an amazing kicker. He really isn't. But because the team loves to play expansive rugby and they love putting him in positions where he can create, yeah, and he can cause havoc. And this World Cup, you've seen, very easy. They've just moved Boden Barrett to fullback. He's not kicking anything. And they just let... Because they know what he brings to the table is a lot, right? So now they have to let Mwanga be the person who kicks, or Damien McKenzie when he's on, or Jody Barrett when he's fit and playing. So I feel for Manny Libok, the player, you know. But if he was playing for another team, if you played for Wales or Ireland, he'd be a top three flyer in the world. Because he just brings so much to the game. And those teams will not let him kick, will not put the pressure of having him as the only recognized fly half in a team that kicks. You know, it's just common sense to the rest of us. So I don't know what the coaching staff saw. Now they've had to bring in Andre Pollard, who, once you bring him in, you've put pressure on the hooking department, as we've just spoken about. Anyway, not all is lost for South Africa. I still feel like they have an amazing chance to do well in this tournament. Last tournament, obviously, they lost. I think they lost a group game. Was it to the All Blacks? I can't remember. But they ended up winning the tournament. So losing one game is not all lost. But they have to get 5 points in their next game against Tonga. Like that has to they have to get 5 points. Because if Scotland win, and for some reason Scotland beat Ireland, which Ireland might decide to rest their players, you never know, right? Ireland might decide to, you know, because Johnny Sexton might not even play that game. Then for some reason, Scotland just win the game. And Scotland had a bye week in week two. So they're going to be playing three games in a row with a break in between. And that third game is going to be against Ireland. So you never know. So for South Africa, they have to get 5 points against Tonga. And yeah, just it's not all is lost. So far, they've done well. That win against Scotland now is looking even better and better, you know. And then they also got a crucial bonus point in this game by losing by less than 7. So that works in their favor. Looking at their group, actually, Ireland, of course, are top on 14 points. Ireland are yet to play Tonga, right? Yeah. Because Tonga have only played... who have Tonga played? No, Tonga have played Ireland. So Ireland are yet to play Romania, right? Ireland are yet to play Scotland. Ireland have played South Africa, they've played Tonga, and they've played Romania. So they have one game left against Scotland. Tonga are yet to play South Africa, yet to play... Romania. I'm getting confused, bro. All you need to know is that South Africa need to beat Tonga, because I know they haven't played each other, and Scotland are playing Tonga tomorrow. Yeah, Scotland are playing Tonga tomorrow, so that's also a must-win Sunday game for Scotland. Then that puts them in a chance, because Tonga can be spoilers. If they win, if they beat Scotland, then that's it for Scotland, you know. But then that bonus point was crucial. Again, as I say, that's why now they're on 10 points. If Ireland, for some reason, lose to Scotland in their next game and South Africa win with a bonus point, you see, that puts them in a good position. They might even top the group. So, yeah, not all is lost. They can still make the quarterfinals. The only thing is now you're going to be facing France in France in a World Cup quarterfinal. Might not be such a bad thing now that Antoine Dupont is injured, and it looks likely that he will not be available for at least the next 3 to 4 weeks, right? Because it's a cheekbone injury. There's no way. If they get into the tournament in like the finals and stuff, then yeah, maybe he has a chance. But fractured jaw, looking unlikely. The French have to use Kouyaté or Luku at scrum half. They already lost in Tamak to an ACL injury. Yeah, that French squad is looking a bit thin. So maybe not such a bad thing to play the French, because I feel like South Africa can beat anyone. Their physicality is just insane on another level. They just need to get their kicks right, because Thomas Ramos is not going to leave kicks on the table. No points will be left on the table with that boy. And France, without Antoine Dupont, will not joke around. Whereas Ireland, you top the group, you're more or less going to face New Zealand. So already we're seeing two potential quarterfinal matchups of South Africa versus France and Ireland versus New Zealand. Blockbusters all through. Rugby World Cup 2023 is heating up, and it's just looking proper. Yeah, and that's it. Ireland beaten South Africa 13-8. Probably should have been the final. Great game. Not all is lost for SA. For Ireland, just keep moving forward and just keep beating whoever comes in front of you. That's what a world number one should be doing.